Hello and welcome to a new episode of Africa Today. Kenyan police said that at least three people have been killed in Western Kenya during an opposition protest over electoral reforms. Details on the front report.
In a statement, Kenyan police said in Siaya they shot dead two people in self-defense during opposition protests. A third man in Kisumu died from a head injury after falling over while running from tear gas. This is the fourth week of protests over the Electoral Commission. The opposition Cord Alliance wants the current members of the Electoral Commission to resign ahead of next year's presidential election. Cord is complaining that they are biased in favor of the governing Jubilee coalition and wanted replaced by a neutral body. Deputy President William Ruto said Monday's protests were illegal on the basis that police were not given adequate warning. Several other places have been caught up in the demonstrations, including the coastal city of Mombasa, where police fired tear gas to prevent protesters from gathering. The opposition says that one of its senators leading protests in the western town of Kakamega has been arrested. Last week, President Uhuru Kenyatta said that if the opposition wanted changes at the Electoral Commission, they should use constitutional procedures to achieve this. According to a government statement, he urged the opposition to exercise mature politics instead of what he termed using illegal means to attract undue attention.
And moving to Sudan, as the UN Security Council are discussing and beginning talks for the renewal of its mission in Darfur, Sudan has stepped up pressure for the withdrawal of the UN peacekeeper forces from the war-torn region. Details on the phone report.
About 20,000 troops and policemen from more than 30 countries are in Sudan's western region of Darfur as part of the African Union United Nations mission, commonly known as UNAMID. Deployed in 2007, UNAMID has a mandate to curb violence in Darfur, a region the size of France. Deadly conflict there since 2003 has left tens of thousands of civilians dead. Khartoum insists that unrest in Darfur has ended and that a referendum held there in April was a clear example of security returning to the war-scarred region. Sudan's Minister of State for Foreign Affairs, Kamel Ismail, said last week in Khartoum that it is time to say goodbye to the UNAMID mission. Violence erupted in Darfur when ethnic minority rebels rose against President Omar al-Bashir, accusing his government of marginalizing the region. Al-Bashir mounted a counterinsurgency, and the UN says at least 300,000 people have been killed in the conflict. Another 2.5 million have fled their homes. Ismail said Khartoum was negotiating through a task force with concerned UNAMID groups to reach a time frame for the mission's exit. Officials said some UNAMID member countries had also expressed a desire to leave or cut troop numbers. UNAMID officials and foreign diplomats said although clashes between government troops and rebels had declined in recent months, the overall situation in Darfur was still a concern.
Welcome back, and to shed more light on the situation in Sudan, we are joined in the studio by Mr. Hamid Al-Tijani, professor at the American University in Cairo. Hello, sir, and welcome to our show.
Thank you so much.
Sir, how do you weigh the call by Sudanese government in order for the UN peacekeepers to leave Darfur?
You know, the UN peacekeeper in Darfur, these are very essential force that is there at least to monitor, to observe what is on the ground. And for the government, cannot be trusted to provide protection to its own victims, because those people that are living on the refugee camps or the people that are being displaced, they cannot trust the government forces, because there are government militias that are brutalizing the citizens, and the only neutral body that is monitor the condition on the ground, to provide facts to the United Nations, to the African Union, to the world community, is the presence of the UNMIT on the ground. So the government cannot be trusted and giving them a blank check for the case in Darfur, because they are part, and still we have an indicted president that he tried to protect himself from the international community, and the condition on the ground is still. What the government has done it, he is trying to indigenize the conflict in Darfur and make it that is become a messier. So now it is very messy. The presence of the international community, and especially the UNMIT, is essential to make sure that is nobody will go there and committing atrocities that cannot be documented or not cannot be traced.
But why he wants the peacekeepers, UN peacekeepers, to leave Darfur? Why he insists on that?
Because he is trying to pretend that there is no, the conflict is finished. He tried to pretend that is the peace was achieved in Darfur. And he tried to have upper hands in the condition of Darfur. And the referendum that has done it recently, that is basically they rigging it, and they try to falsify, and they created a political facade around it to sell to the international community that the conditions are good. And now we created a referendum. Even the referendum itself, it has nothing to do with the...
It's a charade.
Yes.
So, is he with or against the dividing of Darfur?
Because he gave a promises to the militias that he has created, especially what they call the rapid response forces. These are the tribal militias that he promised to give them the power. And for
in
that
in Darfur region?
In Darfur region.
Yeah.
And to give them the power, the only way to go around it is to divide the state into the political cleavages, so that is every those group they have an upper hand, because the division of the Darfur to five areas or to the five states, it has no political economic feasibility. It is very costly to run that massive bureaucracy. In other words, also the resources itself is going to be decimated. We have the farmers and the herders that they are likely to move around the land. Now they are going to be belonging to state. Manage that relation is going to be very problematic. So basically he's dividing the
بين فعاليات جلسه مجلس الوزراء الاعلام العربي اختلفت عن الجلسات السابقه سواء من حيث المواضيع التي طرحت عليها ومن حيث ربطها بالاخبار في الاعلام العربي والتي بدات بتكثير معارك القوات العربيه لبين العرب وجميع الدول العربيه بمناسبه اختلاف التمارين العام من قبل مجلس وزراء الاعلام كما تم تكريمه من قبل الاتحادات والمنظمات ممارسة لمهام إعلامية في منظومة مجلس وزراء الإعلام العربي. المجلس اليوم ناقش واعتمد التوصيات التي تم رفعها من المكتب التنفيذي لمجلس وزراء الإعلام العربي حيث تضمنت الموضوعات المطروحة في جدول الأعمال المجلس تقريبا 17 بندا وعلى رأسها القضية المحورية لجامعة الدول العربية وهي القضية الفلسطينية والقدس وتكريما من المجلس الوزاري لمال القدس من مكانة خاصة في قلب العالم العربي والإسلامي فقد تم إعلان القدس عاصمة الإعلام العربي كان من بين القرارات التي تم اعتمادها اللجنة الدائمة للإعلام العربي والتي تم إعادة العمل فيها بعد توقف دام أكثر من 10 سنوات على اعتبار أنها إحدى اللجان الفنية الدائمة لجامعة الدول العربية ولدورها في متابعة السياسات والبرامج والأنشطة التي تقوم بها الأمانة الفنية لمجلس وزراء الإعلام العربي كما تم إقرار الخطة الجديدة للتحرك الإعلامي العربي في الخارج والتي تهدف إلى التصدي للحملة المعادية وتصحيح الصور النمطية
التي تروج لها بعض وسائل الإعلام الخارجية عن العرب والمسلمين. من أهم المواضيع الجديدة التي طرحت على جدول أعمال المجلس الإعلام وأجندة التنمية المستدامة، والتي يهدف إلى تبني وضع خارطة طريق عربية إعلامية لتنفيذ أجندة التنمية المستدامة 2030، تنطلق من أهدافها 17 وتهدف إلى مساهمة الإعلام لقضايا التنمية المستدامة، وانطلاقا من الاستراتيجية الإعلامية لمكافحة الإرهاب والتي أقرها مجلس وزراء الإعلام العرب عام 2013، فقد أقر المجلس التوصيات المرفوعة في التصدي لظاهرة الإرهاب بهدف تضافر الجهود الإعلامية للدول الأعضاء لمواجهة الإرهاب والذي بات خطرا يهدد استقرار وأمن المنطقة والعالم، والإسهام بقوة في تجديد المضامين الإعلامية فيما يخص مواجهة الإرهاب، حيث أن الإعلام أصبح سلطة مؤثرة للغاية وهو الفضاء الذي يتم خلاله تشكيل العقول، بهدف تطوير منظومة العمل العربي في مجال الإعلام والبحث في أفضل السبل لتمكين الإعلام العربي من القيام بدوره في مكافحة ظاهرة الإرهاب وإسهامه في التوعية من خلال برامج عملية للتصدي للعنف بكل أشكاله وأسبابه ومكافحته بجميع أشكاله وصوره. كما تم اعتماد تقرير وتوصيات فريق الخبراء المتخصص المعني بوضع الإجراءات والخطوات اللازمة من النواحي الفنية والتشريعية والقانونية لوقف بث القنوات الفضائية التي تسيء لأي دولة عربية من الدول الأعضاء وتكليف الأمانة العامة لمتابعة تنفيذ توصياته. التأكيد مجددا على تفعيل قرار مجلس وزراء الإعلام العرب لسنة 2015 بشأن المؤسسة العربية للاتصالات الفضائية والمتضمن تشكيل فريق عمل متخصص من الدول الأعضاء لاقتراح إجراءات وخطوات لازمة من النواحي الفنية والتشريعية والقانونية لوقف بث القنوات الفضائية التي تسيء لأي دولة عربية. أخيرا أقر المجلس تخصيص جائزة التميز الإعلامي للأعوام 2016-2017 للاحتفال بالإذاعة باعتبارها الوسيلة الإعلامية الثانية بعد الصحافة. شكرا جزيلا.
شكرا. اسمح لي. شكرا معالي الوزير. أرجو من اللي أي أحد يريد أن يسأل أن يقول ما اسمه والمؤسسة التي ينتمي إليها. شكرا. تفضل.
فيما يتعلق بالاجتماع أخي العزيز، اليوم الاجتماع كان فيه كثير من المشاعر الطيبة تجاه الدول العربية تجاه بعض. المسؤول في أي موقع في نهاية الأمر هو مواطن عربي مسلم يحرص كل الحرص على حماية مجتمعه، حضارته، تاريخه، في ظل ما نشوفه اليوم من محاولات التحريض على العنف والكراهية تتطلب من الجميع أن يتحمل مسؤولياته. لذلك الاجتماع اليوم فعلا بين المسؤولين عن قطاع الإعلام العربي، ولكن في نهاية الأمر هم مواطنين عرب مسلمين حريصين كل الحرص على وضع خطوات تنفيذية لحماية مجتمعاتنا العربية والإسلامية.
بالله لما تسألوا تكونوا قاعدين. تفضلي سوسن. لا سمحت، لو سمحت خلص سؤالك.
بالنسبة للقنوات اللي تتبع التنظيمات الإرهابية وتروج للعمل الإرهابي، هل ثبتت ضدها موقف قوي يمنع هذه الظاهرة أو يقلل منها؟
احنا الان بصير تشكيل لجنه يتم من خلالها استقبال اي طلب من اي دوله ترى بان هذه القناه تحرض على العنف او الكراهيه او محاوله جر الشعوب لحروب او ازمات طائفيه ليتخذ تجاهها القرار المناسب.
Secretarian problems through speech coming from the Arab League to the people of the problem.
First
and most, no one can suppress freedom. We are not talking about suppressing freedom. We are talking about responsibility towards countries. The responsibility is upon everybody. We don't take decisions to deprive people from their freedom. We don't want things to call for terrorism or instigating terrorism. Everybody has a responsibility. We are never about to suppress freedom. We are talking about ethics of the professional ethics to protect our societies, to save our unity.
Be the first to know. The news live at the site of the event. Information on events as they are happening. If it's breaking news, it's Nile TV.
A very little circle, very narrow circle, and around him, he has no political parties. He don't have even political ideologue who are going to give him a political discourse. So everything that he has is to hang on the power as long as it takes. And find out anything around to hang around. This is what it is. The oppositions, in one hand, they are quite behind compared to the interests of the people of Sudan. Very behind. They need to come up with a clear political roadmap. They need to come up with a political vision of how to govern the country.
Maybe they will not have the enough space to do so.
That's true. This is the triangle that is missing.
Yeah.
Because inside the country, because there is no freedom, there is no civil liberties. The civil society organizations are all being suffocated. They are no longer exist in the country, and the press are not able to voice any objection to the current policies. So internally, the options were limited to the opposition to mobilize. And for the youth, they found out that it's a hopeless case, and that's why we're seeing the massive exodus. We're seeing that people are leaving the country in a massive migration out of the country. The elites are leaving the country, the physicians, doctors, professors, and the professionalists. So the country has become in a very bad in terms of a labor force, in terms of the people that are creative. So it becomes really country in a serious, very serious problem. So the matter of people were rising up, it's just a matter of time. Nobody can predict when it is, but the society is prone because the massive unemployment. The unemployment in the country is almost about 30%. Inflation rate is almost 50%. Poverty rate is moving to 70% according to the government accounting and statistics. Professors are leaving the university in 1,000. In 1 year, about 2,000 professors left the universities and they went to the Gulf. So it is a really serious country is suffering from a very serious problem. And if people are not doing a serious effort, we'll see that soon the country will disintegrate it into the chaos and Bashir will flee the country.
Okay, and do we expect the AU will play a role in the near future regarding the situation not only in Sudan but in Darfur?
You know, the African Union, unfortunately, the African Union, they are in a dilemma. And some groups that are thinking that this is an estate.
But it's only the official body who's responsible for Africa as a whole.
That's true, but they are the thing is, they are with a status quo. The African Union currently with a status quo. They are hoping that the things will continue and hoping that the Bashir will give a little bit of a margins of freedoms so that the business as usual to continue. And they are not understanding the nature that is, which is difficult for Bashir to govern this country in a normal way. And also the country doesn't have the resources that to spend on the machine of al-Bashir to oppress his dissident and the opposition. So it became very difficult. But the African Union are not getting this, and them, you know, Mbeki is the one that is the link between the African Union and Sudan. But unfortunately, he has a vast political interest and economic interest in Sudan. That is, he's not willing to have the courage to sell the truth. And basically, because he has a political empire, economic empire in Sudan by himself, that's also, it's a conflict of interest that is really obvious to everyone, but nobody is bringing that up to the surface.
Sir, finally, and because we're running out of time, what's your expectations for the situation in Sudan?
You know, my expectation is, I think people are looking forward to the future. Nobody is looking for the past. And you're looking for the future, you need to put a new, fresh agenda to the future with a new ideas. That's a very important than the individuals. In the Sudan, we spend a lot of time talking about the past. We spend a lot of time talking about the individuals. But it is time to put the political agenda, to put agenda for moving forward. If the oppositions and the civil society groups work harder, not in the agenda of excluding the others, but inclusion, even the NCP, part of the NCP to be part of the political dialogue, I think there is an opportunity for the new era that will unfold al-Bashir's 2 decades reign in power in Sudan.
Well, Mr. Hamid al-Tijani, professor at the American University in Cairo, thank you very much for joining us and welcome once again to Africa Today.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. And with this, we come to the end of our episode. I'm Dina Mamdouh. Thank you for watching.